Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Just Dare Me by Jackie May, narrated by Mia Madison. Chapter 1. Okay, reader, look. You know how there's that thing about Nora Jacobs that makes her books feel so different from mine? And by different, I mean better? I know you know what I'm talking about, because all your online reviews mention it. I'm talking about that thing that writers call voice, right? And the voice of Nora's books is all, like, endearing and genuine and likable, while my voice is nails on a chalkboard, right? Not to mention the fact that I break the fourth wall, which drives most of you crazy, which also means I have to double down on that, for reasons that you now totally understand, having spent 3 books with me. No, but listen. I'm trying to tell you something incredible about Nora Jacobs. Here it is. That quality of her writing voice? That's the exact quality of her real voice. What I mean is, the books are no embellishment. She really is that genuine and heartfelt and just likable. It's like there's no filter between what's in her heart and the words that come out of her mouth. And that's why it seems completely natural, and so Nora, when she looks up at the moon on this cold, clear night, and at the tail end of a weary sigh says, "Shayne, there are only 3 kinds of men in the world now. Those that fear me, those who want me, and those who weren't in the club the night I ensnared half the city's underworld population with my siren's song." I'm not looking at the moon. I'm looking at Nora. After working with her for 2 months, I know how much this topic weighs on her. It amazes me that even with the love of all her men, Nora's heart still has room enough for the rest of Detroit. She's now a leader in the underworld of this city, and like all the best leaders, she doesn't want their fear or their compliance. She wants their trust. She huffs with disappointment. And there's only one type of woman, those who hate me. I take a puff on the 19th century cigarette holder dangling from my lips and say, "Oh, totally. I hate your guts. Same goes for Elle. That starry look in her eyes every time you walk into the room? That's pure venom. She wishes you never met her brother and put that permanent smile on his face. Same goes for Director West. She told me not to tell you, but she totally regrets hiring you. Now that the Fae have finally signed the FUA treaty, all thanks to you, what great cause is left for her to champion? Look, I hate to break it to you, Nora, but the peace and love and harmony you've brought to Detroit is so not good for our job security. Would you just cut that shit out already?" Her troubled look smooths into an easy grin, which she aims at me with a sideways glance. "Are you kidding me? That starry look on Elle's face is all yours. I've never seen hero worship like she's got for you, and I can literally compel people to be my slaves." "Oh, sure. I'm such a great mentor that I got her banned not only from her own home, but from all of the most prominent houses in the sorcerer community." "Banned from their houses, but not from the bedrooms of their eligible bachelors. Are you kidding? She's the belle of the ball and loving it. When I arrive at the ball, everybody plugs their ears so I won't enslave them for eternity." "Maybe so, but at least you're invited to the ball. Not me. Oh no, not the traitor, the trailer trash fox, bottom of the underworld food chain. I'm not even fit to polish your glass slippers." She arches a brow. "Don't talk to me about bottom of the food chain. I was raised human, remember? Is there anything lower than that?" "Yes," I say too quickly, and before I can stop myself, I add, "falling in love with a human. Even you haven't managed to do that yet." That kills the playful mood. My heart seizes to a grinding halt, like an overworked motor for lack of oil. Nora's face melts with sympathy and concern, all that touchy-feely bullshit that only makes me feel worse. Damn it, I know better than to mention love, to mention anything that reminds me of him. Can't talk about Jay, can't think about him, those things don't help. The only thing that helps, the only thing that matters at all, is to do something about it. That's why we're here tonight, on the balcony of this ritzy underworld nightclub overlooking the Rouge River. Now's not the time to lose my focus. Taking the cigarette holder between two fingers, I blow a bright pink ring of sparkling mist. Some sad sacks we are, huh? Nora levels a fond smile at me. The saddest, feared, misunderstood, human-loving sad sacks. Don't forget outcast and homeless. I live in my car. I live under a bridge. Yeah, but with a dozen men to keep you company. And I love them, she says in earnest. They're more than enough. In fact, Shayne, sometimes I wish I could lock myself in with them and never come out again. How antisocial of you. But it's... She looks to me with something like hesitation, afraid I won't agree. It's just too much sometimes, isn't it? The responsibility, I mean. How has it come to be us that everybody looks to for help? Not me. Are you kidding? Do you not remember the deflated, tear-soaked puddle of flesh I was when you found me? I wouldn't even be able to stand up on 2 feet if it weren't for you. Nora groans. Oh, that's not helping. That's just more responsibility. Hello? Have you gotten to know me at all in the last 2 months? Don't you know that you happen to be talking to the undisputed reigning queen of deflecting responsibility? I'm like the Aretha Franklin of running away. First of all, that's not true, no matter how much you want people to think it is. And second of all... She steps in close and clasps my hand in both of hers. Can't we? Can't we run away? I'm talking about when all this is over, and you've got your man back, and I've got mine. Can't we all just go? I don't know where. It doesn't matter, does it? Wouldn't we deserve that? Nick Gorgeous is a billion years old. Shouldn't it be up to people like him to run this city, not us? She's not wearing gloves, but I don't mind the physical contact. After 2 months, there's nothing she could read in my thoughts that she doesn't already know about me. I give her hands a squeeze. I guess I don't have to speak my answer, right? Mortified, she drops my hand and steps back. Oh, sorry. No, seriously. What did you see? Nothing. I didn't even realize I had... Don't give me that crap, Nora. What did you see? I can't see your thoughts, I swear. I can only hear them. Oh, good. So much less invasive. It really is. Trust me. You know I trust you. Now come on. What did you hear in my thoughts just now? She thinks about it for a moment. There's a slight breeze out here on the balcony. The sounds of the river in the darkness below us. Well, she says, finally, it was you and... Yes, me and... And him. You were having a talk, just like the one we're having now, only it was you telling him you wanted to run away. I take a long drag on the vintage cigarette holder. Pink, sparkly vapor fills my lungs with warmth and my mind with relaxation. It's just enough to keep despair at bay. Take that edge off. Enough for me to force a thin smile. That's right. I told Jay the same thing you just told me. Let's run away. Get out of here. Far away from anybody and anything. Just the two of us. Isn't that all that matters?
Exactly. And what did he say?
You didn't get that far?
No, honestly.
I nod for a long moment, buying time to wrangle my emotions, to control my breathing. He said he couldn't take me away from Detroit. He couldn't do that to this city. Nora gasps.
He said that?
Yep, and trust me, that's the least of the sappy shit he says.
She presses her hands to her heart.
What a sweetheart! Charlie is swooning from all the way back home. I can feel him feeling me right this second. Come on, you know how that kind of talk triggers my gag reflex.
We're going to get him back, Shayne. We will find him. He's out there, just waiting for you.
I turn away to hide sudden tears. Jay's out there, all right. Out there in the hands of the most cruel, most vicious monsters of Detroit's underworld. They need him, so they can't kill him yet. But is that any consolation? I remember how damaged and broken Jay was when I first met him. What he's going through now is worse than that. Way worse. So I have to wonder, even if we do find him, will there be anything left of the Jay Brenner I know? My temper flares. Every second is vital. We need to make our move now. But to do that, we need to be alone on this balcony, and some white-bearded, shit-faced sorcerer in a $5,000 suit is taking his sweet-ass time smoking a cigar. Oblivious to us, he croons, off-key, to a sultry cover of Hall & Oates' Maneater playing in the club.
Oh, here she comes. Watch out, boy, she'll chew you up.
He hiccups, belching thick cigar smoke into the frigid night air. The Motown Rouge is a local riff on the infamous Moulin Rouge of Paris. Same filthy rich patrons, same lurid cabaret courtesans, but instead of a red windmill on the roof, you get a giant radiator fan because Detroit. The club is perched on stilts at the point of a peninsula overlooking the confluence of our two most famous rivers. To the east, the Detroit River, lined with glittering downtown city lights. To the west, the dark Rouge River, winding inland past countless relics of the industrial age. Water treatment plants, oil refinery plants, automotive plants, any kind of industry requiring access to shipping lanes. I take Nora by the elbow.
Come with me.
Wait, what? She lowers her voice to a hiss.
Shayne, why are we going over to this guy? This isn't the plan.
No, look, I just want to show you that we're not as bad off as you make it sound. We are not total sad sacks. We can have perfectly normal conversations with nice folks. I deposit Nora on one side of the gentleman while I step to his other side. I tap his shoulder. Hey, Alfred, bum a ciggy off ya? Startled, the man inhales cigar smoke too quickly and erupts with a fit of coughing. When I start pounding him on the back, he shrugs me away, annoyed.
Enough! Stop that! Good gods, woman, you pack some wallop. You must be half ogre.
His voice trails off as he gets a look at my face. Disgust curls his lips into a sneer.
You,
he growls, and he backs away, bumping into Nora. He stares at her, mouth agape.
You!
Sorry, she says awkwardly, with a cute little shrug. Enjoying your night? The cigar drops from his lips. His voice is raspy with fright.
Yes, fine. The night.
When Nora smiles at him, the man leaps backward with a terrified squeak, bumping into me.
Uh-oh, here she comes, I sing along. Watch out, boy, she'll chew you up.
Nora, desperate to put him at ease, pulls at the man's arm. Sir, really, we didn't mean to...
Unhand me, he screams. Don't touch me. Don't talk to me. Ah, my ears!
He clamps his hands over his ears. All the while, I'm patting him down.
Say, mister, about that ciggy?
His terror turns to outrage.
Get your paws off me, you traitorous, two-faced tramp!
Nora's eyes widen.
Hey, I dare you to say that again.
She pushes him toward me. I push him back toward her.
Go on, Alfred. Say it again. She dares you.
She pushes him back to me.
Nobody talks to her like that. Got it?
I push him back. Put your hands down. Look at a lady when she's talking to you.
A blight on this city,
he screams, staggering away from us.
That's what you are, a blight and a scourge on this city, the both of you.
Nora, bless her little short-fused heart, is suddenly red-faced with anger. Picking up the smoldering end of his cigar, she chucks it at him with impressive speed and aim.
Choke on it! Don't show your face here again!
Or I'll take it clean off with my razor-sharp claws, I shout.
I'll shatter your puny, fragile mind with my siren song.
I'll take your balls off, your sagging, wrinkly balls, and feed them to my blood-starved labradoodle. Yeah, so the guy was long gone, 2 threats ago. Now we're just shouting at a closed door, alone on the balcony. I take a long, soothing breath. Meh. I feel like that last one was a bit cliche. With guys, it always ends up being about the balls, you know? Nora's chest is heaving with anger. Some of her perfectly placed hair has fallen down into her flushed face.
They have a right to fear me. They've seen what happens when I can't control my powers. They can hate me all they want. But you? They don't know the first thing about you, Shayne. What you've sacrificed for them.
The storm passes from her face as quickly as it came. Her shoulders drop. She hangs her head in her hands.
Not sad sacks, huh? Not antisocial, reclusive, misunderstood outcasts?
Nora, did you not hear a word that man said? A blight and a scourge, he said. Very different than outcast or sad sack. Which one do you want, blight or scourge? You seem more like a blight to me. Yeah, I'm definitely a scourge. Nora shakes her head, exasperated, but now with a reluctant smile.
Everything just glances right off you, Shayne.
If you really believe that, I'd love to play poker with you sometime. But now that we're finally alone out here, I'll quote one of my favorite songs from the Pointer Sisters.
And that is? I jerk my head toward the balcony railing.
Jump. Nora's smile spreads, showing perfect white teeth.
I thought you'd never ask.
Hitching up the skirt of her cocktail dress, she climbs to the top of the railing and leaps off. After a silent 30-foot fall, she points her toes for a perfect plunge into the Rouge River. Chapter 2. When I climb down the balcony to the rocky shore, Nora has shifted into her siren, bobbing up and down in the water. I can never get used to how stunning she becomes in this form. She shimmers with scales of pearlescent purple and teal, and her eyes are so exotic, framed with swirls of color, shining in the darkness under the balcony. She even can't help being beautiful when she wrinkles her nose with a scowl to complain.
Ugh, this water is nasty. It's like trying to breathe in a room full of smoke.
I know. It's from all the factories and processing plants. All their oil and industrial waste runs off into the river. That's why nobody ever swims in it.
Wait, what?
I locate the duffel bag we hid in the rocks early this morning. I'd bet you're probably the first person to get in the Rouge River since it caught on fire in the 1950s.
Shayne, caught on fire?
Yeah, the water itself caught on fire from being so oily. Can you believe that?
Yes, I really can.
Relax. I'm about to be the second person to get in that shit.
But you don't have to breathe it.
Just wait till you see the child-size wetsuit I have to wear. Trust me, I'm the one getting the raw deal here. To demonstrate, I find the thick neoprene head cap in the duffel bag and pull it over my head. The heavy material feels like 2 giant hands surrounding my head and pressing inward, trying to crush my skull. My whole face gets scrunched into a tiny round opening, forcing my brows down over my eyes and pushing my lips out like a duckbill.
Nora bursts into laughter. I would have a few choice words for her, but I can't talk with duck lips, so two middle fingers will have to do. 5 painful minutes later, I've tucked, stuffed, and pinched my whole body into the rest of the wetsuit. I fish a small, waterproof fanny pack from the duffel and clip it around my waist. After slinging a small air tank on my back, I shove a breathing mouthpiece between my duck lips, and we're ready to go. To say that Nora is a fast swimmer is a major understatement. You're better off saying she's a slow dolphin. It takes all my strength to hold onto her shoulders as she speeds us up the river just below the surface. My fingers start to cramp from clutching so tightly. I squeeze my eyes shut and focus on feeling the directions we take. I've memorized the map of the river. I know exactly where we are, and I'm surprised to realize that we've already arrived at our destination. Nora must be amped up. She swam faster than any of our trial runs. I squeeze her shoulders, and she slows down. We dip down, almost to the riverbed, before she goes absolutely still, allowing our natural buoyancy to take us up. Silently, we raise our eyes just above the surface. We're underneath a dock, which means we've just made a 3-mile trip underwater, completely blind, and nailed a bullseye. I'd smile, if only I could move my lips. Footsteps above us, a guard pacing up and down the dock. I'm relieved to hear that he's alone. This should be no problem. We swim to the end of the dock and wait for his footsteps to approach. I feel the water beneath our feet begin to ripple and whirl. Nora is building up energy, summoning strength and purpose to the water. Just as the guard reaches the end of the pier, Nora raises her fist. In response, we are both lifted by a powerful surge of water. It's like taking an elevator that stops, ding, on the level of the dock. Suddenly, we're looking straight into the eyes of a startled demon. Stepping onto the dock, I punch him in the face. But the ice-cold water has frozen my fingers. The punch hurts me more than him. I grunt swear words through duck lips. Just before the guard can shout into his radio, Nora grabs him by the lapels, and with a soft humming of a single musical note, like lulling a baby to sleep, she lays him back on the dock. He smiles in a giddy stupor. I rip my head cap off. Just like that, he's yours now? Nah, I only gave him enough juice for 1 or 2 racy dreams is all. There, see that? She points to the crotch of his pants, where there's now an obvious sharp bulge. Whoa, a big boy. Nora shrugs. Meh. Ew. No. I get that we're close friends now, but don't be trying to tell me stuff like how big Rook's junk is. I wasn't talking about Rook. I was talking about Oliver. An uncontrollable shout is just about to escape my lips when Nora clamps a hand over my mouth. Focus, Shayne. Get the earpiece. Let's check in. After stealing one more glance at the bulge, I nod and she releases me. Opening the waterproof fanny pack, I find 2 earpieces, 1 for each of us, and a phone that is already live with a call. We're on site, I say. Special Agent Danny Russo of the FBI Underworld Task Force answers with his booming voice.
There she is, ladies and gents. Welcome to the party, pal.
Cut the chatter, Special Agent Hillerman snaps. We've been scooped. This isn't our fight anymore. I trade looks with Nora.
You're shitting me.
She shits you not, Russo says. They beat us to the punch by a good minute. Move fast. It's going down.
As if on cue, automatic gunfire erupts from somewhere above us. We rush the length of the dock and up a flight of concrete steps to the shipping yard of a petroleum processing plant. A row of enormous steel silos tower over us, blocking the moon. A fierce gunfight breaks out,
bright muzzle flashes strobing from a dozen different windows, roofs, and gangways. I see dark figures sprinting through the steam that belches from vents and pipes. I pull a handgun from the fanny pack. Where are you guys at? I can't tell who's who.
Front entrance, Hillerman says. It's too late. Best we can do is hold these positions and block their retreat. They can't get to their cars without going through us, and they can't take a boat without going through you.
Her plan sounds logical, but my brain wants to buck any form of restraint, wants to rush into those buildings. It took us 3 weeks to plan this raid, and 3 weeks before that of gaining intel on this place, meticulously fitting puzzle pieces together. The picture formed by those puzzle pieces shows the East Side Demon Horde using this processing plant as a safe house in which they've been holding a priority asset, someone damn important to their cause. Hillerman gave an 80% chance that this damn important somebody is my damn important somebody. If Jay's in there, I have to go.
Hold your positions, Hillerman orders.
This is our op. We've been planning it for weeks.
Nora's voice breaks in. Is it the Windsor clan again?
Affirmative. Check your 8 o'clock.
We look to our left, where a bright green flare lights the yard. The calling card of the Windsor vampire clan. This is the third time our raid has been interrupted by those damn green flares. They keep piggybacking our operations, swooping in to clear the place out before we get anything. Suddenly, a black silhouette rises in front of the flare. I recognize that shape, the 12-foot wingspan and needle-sharp beak of a monstrous crow demon.
She's here! It's Biona!
I shout, and I jerk the slide on my gun to cock it.
Hold positions!
You said if she was here, that would make the odds 99%. He's here. Jay is here. I don't wait for a response. There's no order in the world that could stop me now. I take off, sprinting across the shipping yard, taking as big a stride as the tight wetsuit will allow. There's screaming in my ear, probably Hillerman and Nora at the same time. I've only closed half the distance, but I'm too impatient to wait another second. I stop, raise the gun, and squeeze off 3 quick shots. My heart soars when Biona turns, not hit, but at least I got her attention. Her beady black eyes stare right at me, watch me raise the gun and peer straight down the sights at her forehead. My finger is just beginning to squeeze the trigger when one of the silos explodes, lighting up the entire shipping yard. The shockwave blasts me off my feet. When my senses recover, I'm looking up at the night sky, waiting for my lungs to snap back so I can breathe. All is quiet, not just because my eardrums have been damaged, but because the fight is over. Sitting up, I suck in a giant gasp of air, then cough it straight out again. The yard is deserted. No more gunfire. That's good, right? They didn't come this way, which means they had to go through Hillerman and Russo.
You got them?
I ask between wheezing coughs.
They went for their cars?
I put my fingers to my ear. The earpiece is gone. No matter, here comes Hillerman and Russo now, trotting in full tactical gear. Russo calls out,
You got them? They went for the river?
Are you kidding? They didn't come this way. They went your way.
That's a negative, he says with a sigh.
With a frustrated growl, Hillerman kicks a piece of rubble.
How can they just be gone? What are they going to do? Walk home?
Nora's voice rings out from behind a stack of crates. Over here! We find her crouching over a dead thug with an East Side tattoo on his shoulder. The guy's neck has been opened by a savage vampire bite, spilling every last ounce of his blood onto the cement. Russo lets out a low whistle.
Windsor ain't here to feed, that's for sure.
Nora closes her eyes,
takes a deep breath, and places her fingertips on the back of the man's head. Immediately, her brow creases with concentration as she watches the guy's final moments from his own point of view. She winces, then opens her eyes and stands up. Female vamp with short hair. Young, maybe 20? It's odd.
What?
I ask. She bit into him, and then she dropped him and looked up suddenly, like she heard something.
Yeah, a big-ass explosion. I'm still hearing it.
No, it was in the other direction. Nora points out into a field beside the shipping yard. She looked out there, and then she took off running.
Nothing out there, Hillerman says. Just fields. It's good enough for me.
Tearing off the wetsuit, I shift into my fox, and with three large strides, I'm at a full sprint across that field. Hillerman's right. There's jack shit out here.
Unless they entered a secret underground cave like in a James Bond movie, there's just no way they could've...
Wait. There. On the horizon, I see a dark line cutting through the field. I know exactly what that is. I leap over the dark lines of a train track, then double back to step between the rails to lay my head on them. Still warm. Trains! We've been focusing on cars all this time, following them in and out of East Side, putting trackers on their bumpers, running their plates through the system, tracing ownership through VIN numbers, hitting dead end after dead end. That's because they're using freight trains to move around. It's clever. Detroit is crawling with train tracks. You can move large numbers of people to any part of the city at any time, day and night. I look up and down the line, but see only darkness. I listen, but hear only my own pitiful whines. They're gone again. He's gone again. Chapter 3. There's a weight on my legs. I open one bleary eye and glance down to see a giant, black, curly-haired labradoodle at my feet. In his usual fashion, Muppet lays his head across my ankles. But he's not sleeping any more than I am. His ears perk when he sees me eyeing him. He jumps down from the couch, bouncing the cushions. I groan. My inner clock says it's still the middle of the night. Even though my body is exhausted, my mind is nowhere near calm enough for any kind of good sleep. Frustrating, but not surprising. Before Jay, I could sleep comfortably anywhere, anytime. Now, without him, there's no such thing as comfort. I haven't slept through a single night since Nora brought me here to crash on the couch in the safety of Terrence's underground fortress. Muppet comes up to my face, sniffing and panting. I push him away. He comes right back. I push him away, and he comes right back. I drag myself up, folding my legs beneath me on the couch.
Let me guess. We're up for the day, right?
Excited, Muppet jumps onto the couch, then off again. His enthusiasm is annoying. Plus, he's giant. He weighs 75 pounds, so it hurts when his tail gets wagging and whips me. Ow! Would you sit?
Sit!
He doesn't sit, of course. He tries to lick me instead. I shove him away.
Would you just... We'll go, okay? We'll go for a walk. But food first. Go get your food.
Food is the only word he obeys. There's a comical moment when he's stuck running in place, his paws slipping across the smooth tile. I push his ass with my foot, and that sets him off. He races across the kitchen to his enormous bowl. Living at Terrence's den under the Ambassador Bridge is no picnic for me, but Muppets in heaven. The place has plenty of room for running, and there's always way too much food lying around since Nora's men are constantly eating. With so many people under one roof, bridge, every meal is a feast, and meat is always on the menu. I feel like shit. My prescription meds for ADHD ran out 2 weeks ago, and it shows. In the few seconds it takes me to trudge into the kitchen, I've thought of three different things I need to be doing right now. Shower, brush my hair and/or my teeth, and put on clean clothes. But doing any one of those seems like a monumental task at the moment. I'd much rather spend my effort ignoring the guilt of not doing them, so I sit on a bar stool in my underwear and lay my cheek on the countertop. If Jay were here, he'd say something snarky about, well, actually, the first thing he'd say is, why don't I just go and get the damn refill on my pills? And then he'd say something snarky about walking around somebody else's house in my underwear. It's cute when he acts so prudish. Humans will never get past that, I think. They'll never be comfortable with nudity the way underworlders are. That's a random thought to have. Why am I even thinking about this? Oh yeah, I was thinking if Jay were here. I blink out of my stupor and push away from the counter. My fox is just as anxious as Muppet to get out of this dungeon, get some night air. But I don't dare touch the alarm system. Terrence is always changing the code, and one wrong entry will light this place up like a Christmas tree. If Christmas trees had blinding strobe lights and ear-piercing bullhorns. Pausing outside the master bedroom, I put my ear to the door and listen. All is quiet. I ease the handle down and step inside. As expected, I am instantly seized by bitter envy. Nora sleeps peacefully in the center of a gargantuan bed, and she is surrounded by naked bodies, none of which is a slobbering labradoodle. No, these are man bodies with bulging biceps and rippling abs, hard jawlines, and soft lips. The inner circle is pressed up against her on either side, but also at her feet and head. The outer ring of men is snuggled up to them, but reaching across their bodies in order to touch Nora, if only with a finger. Hot tears swim in my vision as self-pity steals my thoughts away. I forget why I came in here. All I can think of is the fact that I'm not asking too much of the universe. I'm not. I don't want what Nora has. She could literally have it all, if she wanted. She could claim every man in Detroit. I don't need that. I only want one. Just one. One out of millions. From behind me comes the sound of somebody shifting in a seat. It's Parker, of course. Wearing one of his impeccable suits, he sits in a luxurious recliner, one leg draped over the other, his open laptop resting on an end table next to a half-empty glass of wine. Thankfully, he knows why I came in here. In silence, he walks me out, gently closing the door behind us. You were standing there a full minute. Which means you were watching me a full minute, wondering what thoughts might be racing through your mind. My thoughts don't race, I lie. Sometimes it makes me grumpy that everybody assumes I'm always scatterbrained, even if they may be right. Muppet bounds ahead of us, leaping up the entryway staircase 5 steps at a time. I move ploddingly, pulling at the railing with each step. Parker's dress shoes make light tapping sounds that echo in the dark. He gives a little sigh, which I have come to learn is a sign of displeasure. Not the best night for a walk. Rain coming. Just what Muppet needs, a good rain. You won't go far, I hope. Far is subjective. What do you consider far? Brenner's house is far. Too far.
You mean our house? Why would I go there?
I don't know. Maybe just to stare at it for a full minute.
Or 2. Or 20. So what?
It's exactly what they're hoping you'll do. One of these nights, they'll be waiting there.
Great. Saves us the trouble of finding them again.
We've reached the top landing. Muppet paws at the front door.
What if I told you, as the deputy director of the FUA, not to go back to your house?
Is that what you're doing?
Is that what you want me to do?
What the hell kind of circular argument is that?
I simply wonder if you'd rather be told what to do these days. Frankly, you seem lost.
Really? Well, frankly, you seem...
I bite my tongue, recognizing that critical moment just before I lose control of my temper. I close my eyes and exhale deeply while reciting a mantra.
Less words, more listening. Less words, more feeling. Less words.
I clasp my hands together and look him in the eyes. And now I'm listening to you.
Parker is stunned.
Are you?
No, I'm not. But right now, it's enough that I'm saying the words.
I look at him, unblinking, my mouth closed. A long silence draws out between us. He smiles.
Incredible. You've been practicing this.
I speak in a rehearsed, even tone. It's Nora. She seems to think, and this is idiotic and totally not true, that maybe I sometimes let a little drama escalate into a big drama by over-communicating. And don't you dare laugh at that, or I'll over-communicate your face.
His smile deepens.
I envy the time you spend with her. We all do.
I shake my hands out, feeling more in control now.
Hey, I'm happy to give her back to you guys, because that would mean I got Jay back. Until then, she refuses to leave me alone.
I know. We've all committed to that end, Shayne. We won't quit. None of us. Until he's home.
Boy, I thought my mom's guilt trips were bad. I clear my throat, and I open my mouth to speak, but no words come out. Parker gives me an expectant look, waiting patiently. I clear my throat louder this time, and only when I look down at my shoes am I finally able to mutter, "Thank you."
You're welcome, Shayne. Truly. Practice your listening now, and hear me.
He waits for me to look into his eyes.
You are welcome here. Moreover, you are welcome with her anytime, even after this is all over. Do you know, for all the physical needs that I and her other men have fulfilled?
Gross! He raises a finger.
For all that, I wonder if there hasn't been a lingering emotional need left unfulfilled. Until now, Nora's never spent this much time with a female friend, having girl time. I'll bet she confides in you, doesn't she? Tells you things she's never told us.
She joked about how big Oliver's junk is.
He shrugs.
That's common knowledge.
I recall Nora's talk about wanting to pack up all her men and run away from Detroit, from all the responsibility of being Nora Jacobs. That kind of insecurity is not something you'd want to share with lovers who worship you. That's straight-up girl talk territory.
Well, if she did confide in me, I sure as hell ain't sharing with you, so...
He raises his hands.
By all means, keep it between the two of you. She needs that kind of outlet. She needs a friend like you, Shayne. It's my turn to say, most sincerely, thank you.
A warmth spreads through my chest. I feel like I can breathe deeper.
Jeez. Is this what happens when people listen rather than shout at each other?
Parker chuckles.
Oh, you're not as ignorant as you want people to think. I've seen you with Jay. I've seen the way you listen to each other, as if the rest of the world no longer exists.
Because it doesn't. Not for me.
I don't believe that. I've been watching you, and I think I've discovered your dirty little secret. The thing Jay loves about you, but which you're scared to death of anyone else finding out.
Gosh, this sounds juicy.
Why don't you let me in on the secret?
It's something you guard. Keep hidden away. Pretend it's not there. Mask it with sarcasm and witty banter. But Jay saw it. And Nora sees it. And I see it. Hell, maybe everybody sees it. Maybe they always have.
Great! Can I see it?
It's your heart, Shayne. It's bigger than you think, the space in your heart. You think Jay has filled it up, but there's more room than even he can fill. Much more. In fact, I think it's big enough to fit the entire city of Detroit. And that's why it scares you, because love is responsibility.
Oh, that's just swell, boss. I can't even take care of myself, and now I'm supposed to feel responsible for all of Detroit?
That responsibility was self-assumed by many from the generation that helped to foster and raise this city, including the great Dottie Davies.
Wow. You're going to bring my dying grandma into this?
You're more like her than you think.
With a groan, I pull my shirt off over my head and throw it at the door. Why does everybody I know feel the need to tell me what and who I am?
Maybe because it's obvious to everybody who knows you, who has been drawn to you, the same way that so many felt drawn to the protective care of your little Bunika all those years ago. It's obvious to all those who feel better with you by their side, feel stronger, feel as though they would follow you anywhere, no matter how dangerous. Your destiny is to...
My destiny! I try to talk over him, but he won't relent.
Your destiny, he repeats with raised voice, is to lead, to stand at the front of this wild pack we call Detroit. And if you dispute that, you're either dumb or blind or just too stubborn. But my personal bet would be all three.
I'm left with my mouth hanging open. Parker has always been frank with me, but never emotional, never raw. It's almost as if we were talking as longtime friends rather than co-workers. When did that happen? What in the damn hell's going on? For once, I'm almost tongue-tied. I want to get Jay back. There's nothing else, Parker. That's all I want.
That's just it. Everybody knows what you want, Shayne. But sometimes life has a way of taking away what we want in order to force us to see what we need.
I'm so frustrated that I literally try to pull my hair out. But what I need is Jay. Did you think about that? What if what I want and what I need are the same thing? Win-win. It's obvious Parker doesn't like my answer. With another of his annoyed sighs, he enters a code into the security keypad by the door, unlocking it. He pulls it open for me.
In 60 seconds, the alarm will reactivate. Enjoy your walk.
I don't bother trying to say something snarky to get the last word. Stripping my underwear off, I shift with the intent of bounding out the open door. But just enough irritation carries over into my fox brain that I can't help myself. I snap at Parker's ankles. He leaps back with a hiss of anger. After I make my escape with Muppet, he slams the door. Chapter 4. In Detroit, it's not uncommon to see a wild fox roaming the alleys or to spot a stray dog on the streets. It would be uncommon, however, to see a fox and a dog walking side by side as though they're pals, which is exactly how Muppet always wants to be. Sometimes I allow it, in places that are unpopulated, with no risk of being seen. But if a car comes, or people are out in their yards, I have to bolt, pretending to flee from the big bad dog who wants to eat me. It's humiliating. Plus, Muppet thinks it's a fun game, so he gets all excited and tries to tackle me or nip at my tail, the big oaf. It's perfectly cold out. Just the right temperature. April is a month of compromise for weather in Detroit.
On one hand, we go from miserably freezing to nice sweater weather. On the other hand, we go from dry to wet. The most acceptable form of greeting in April is to sigh and say, "Here comes the rain again," to which I always reply, "Great song." I take us on our usual route, a 5-mile loop that starts in the industrial sector and will bring us home through residential neighborhoods. We sniff at dumpsters, chase raccoons, and scare the crap out of a drunk guy who mistakes Muppet for a bear. The highlight of our loop comes at the transition from industrial to residential blocks. There's a back alley that runs behind a series of warehouses for a 1/4 mile, straight and clear, a perfect strip for racing. I've always won these races, but each time my margin of victory shrinks. I think that in a fair race, speed versus speed, Muppet would win, but I'm too vain to play fair if that means losing against an animal that is gullible enough to fall for my tricks. Muppet knows we're getting close. He sticks to my side and watches me with jittery anticipation. I have to be careful. At the slightest provocation from me, any quick movement or step in the direction of the alley, he'll be off like a shot. We cross a street to enter the alley, but still I play it cool, feigning interest in a toppled garbage can. Even though the can is empty, I poke my head inside and sniff around, knowing that Muppet will copy me. Sure enough, he edges his way past me into the can, forcing me to back out. That's when I make my move. I bolt down the alley, spurred by the sound of Muppet flipping out, banging his head on the inside of the can as he scrambles to get away. I've given myself a good head start. The alley is a blur, whipping past at 30 miles an hour, faster than the world's fastest human. In 30 seconds, I've run the entire 1/4 mile. Amazingly, Muppet has caught up. We finish neck and neck. It's a good thing dogs have no capacity to understand winning or losing, or else Muppet would be gloating the whole way home. Instead, he wags his tail like crazy and leaps all around me as if to say, "Let's go again." I'm tempted to start another race, only to stop and see how long it takes him to notice, like when you fake throwing a ball. Suddenly, we're both startled by savage barking from a huge Doberman pincher. I feel like those cats you see in cartoons that jump 4 feet straight up and all their fur sticks out. Luckily, the beast is on the other side of a chain-link fence. Muppet backs away, his head tilted in confusion at such an angry greeting. He gives a hopeful wag of his tail, but the Doberman only gets angrier, throwing itself at the fence with bared teeth. I feel a strange sense of contempt for such a rude response. Muppet's unfailing cheeriness can be annoying, but it doesn't deserve the dog equivalent of a middle finger. Besides, if anybody's going to treat Muppet that way, it's going to be me. I feel compelled to put myself between the two of them with the intention of nudging Muppet away, and that's when the weirdest thing happens. As soon as I take one step toward the fence, the Doberman shuts his mouth and lowers his head. I immediately freeze with a chill racing down my spine because I'm absolutely certain that the beast must have spotted a threat behind me, someone or something terrifying. But whipping my head around to look, I see nothing. When I turn back to the Doberman, he lowers his head even more and steps away from the fence. Now I'm really freaked out, because maybe there's a ghost around, or we're about to have an earthquake. Dogs are supposed to be able to sense ghosts and earthquakes, right? I ask Muppet with a tilt of my head, "Isn't that right, Muppet?" But by the way he furiously wags his tail, all he can sense at the moment is rainbows and cupcakes. Back to the Doberman. The longer I stare at him, the lower he drops his head, until finally his chin rests on the pavement. There's no doubt about it. He's acting submissive. To me, which I feel goes without saying, is a first. I've never known any aggressive dog to act anything but hungry toward me, even Chihuahuas. Forget about Dobermans.
I mean, you'd think I'd be flattered or excited, right? But I'm too stunned to feel anything. As a final test, I take the tiniest step toward the fence, and that's game over. The Doberman's legs skitter and tangle, tripping him up. He rolls over, finds his footing, and sprints away. Muppet hasn't the slightest clue that anything weird has happened, but I've got the jitters now. Something's not right, and I don't like it. I turn in slow circles, scanning every window, rooftop, and dark corner in sight. I don't see anything. I don't hear anything. We roam in silence after that. Muppet, not because he's spooked. He's obliviously chipper, as always, but because he takes cues from me. And right now, I'm trying to get us home as quickly and stealthily as possible. I dart from shadow to shadow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.